After the PM's smackdown yesterday,
the Chinese government should be totally ashamed.
The gloves are off.
It's the work of a stupid high school student.
I don't know what the hell Twitter's waiting for. Take it down, it's fake.
I am gobsmacked by the intervention by China yesterday.
Last week I said boycott Chinese product, and I mean it.
Our Kiwi neighbours also going into bat for us over the doctored image of an Aussie soldier slitting the throat of an Afghan child.
New Zealand has registered directly with Chinese authorities. Our concern over the use of that image, it was an unfactual post.
But China isn't backing down.
I would advise Mr Morrison to face reality and put his effort on domestic affairs, like making sure that his military becomes more disciplined.
That's the propaganda artist behind the fake image. While the Chinese embassy this afternoon released a statement saying that the rage and roar of politicians and media is an overreaction. State-run media going even further, saying that Scott Morrison should kneel down, slap himself in the face and kowtow. It's a dangerous place for Australia to be, given the ongoing trade war threatening to rob us of billions of dollars and hundreds of thousands of jobs.
This isn't an esoteric or a theoretical concept. This is deeply practical and real. Real people with real lives and real expenses that are going to lose their jobs if this relationship isn't put into a better place.
So is there any saving this rocky relationship, or is the China-Australia partnership permanently in the bin?
Well, Professor Rana Mitter is an author and expert in Chinese history and politics from Oxford University, and he joins us now. So, Professor, is there any saving our relationship with China?
There is, but I think it demands a certain amount of quite skilled diplomacy. First of all, it's important that, as Prime Minister and other people have been doing, that it's clear that this sort of faked-up post is unacceptable. I think it's perfectly OK to say that clearly. But I think Australia's also going to need to make sure that it's got its friends on board. And Australia has an awful lot of friends in the world. So talking to the new incoming Biden administration, talking to the EU, talking to us here in the UK about putting forward a firm, friendly, but frank approach that tells China that this sort of language really isn't acceptable.
Professor, the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, was visibly angry speaking about this yesterday, had some very stern words. Is it a mistake, do you think, for him and our other politicians to call China out so strongly on this?
I don't think it is a mistake, but it's also important to make sure that the next step beyond that is thought through. So once the language has been used on both sides, and I think you have to think of those foreign ministry statements a bit like the statements from the outgoing Trump administration in the US. A lot of it is performance. A lot of it is actually intended for domestic consumption, where these foreign ministry spokespeople are kind of heroes on domestic social media. So that's part of what's going on. But beyond that, I think it's important for Australia, as other countries should be doing, to think about how they can make sure that they can state their national interests while keeping the trade relationship going. And on that, I think it's important to remember that China also has vulnerabilities in the World Trade Organization, in RCEP, the major free trade agreement, which Australia and China have inked. There are opportunities for a more measured kind of firm but fair diplomacy.
So could this be a misstep from China then, Professor? Because it has united Australian politicians. They agree on very little, but they were unequivocal in their agreement here. It's united our allies around the world as well. Is it a misstep?
It is a misstep, because what will happen next is that lots of countries like my own, the United Kingdom, which are thinking of expanding trade with China, will become very, very nervous. They will think, well, if you expose your trade to the level of trade that Australia has, about 33% of your total, and then you find yourself vulnerable in this sort of way, is that a relationship that you want to build up? And I think that China actually is, in a sense, in the middle of a kind of foreign policy debate. There are more moderate voices out there, and if you look, you can find them, who are actually saying this kind of very confrontational diplomacy doesn't do us any good. The issue is that right now those voices are not in the ascendant in China, but they do exist, and trying to give them some leeway and some encouragement is also an important part of the next stage of diplomacy after this initial angry clash of words.
So, Rana, just for context, in Australia, this looks like the whole world. It looks like all China cares about is Australia. You would follow this from the other side of the world. Is Australia genuinely being singled out here, or is China doing this to everybody and we're just paying attention to this bit?
Australia's being singled out right now, Waleed, but there are other countries in the recent past that have gone under the fire. Sweden over here in Europe is one of the countries that for a while was very much in the firing line. The issue, as I've said, is that actually countries which want to deal with China, want to do that trade, want to be part of the world trading network with this very large, important economy, which of course it is, are going to have to talk to each other more to work out where there is the capacity to let perhaps some of the language go by the board after pushing back on it, and where there are real issues of principle, such as trade barriers and tariffs being put up, that the rest of the world has to use WTO, RCEP and these other organisations to say to China, you're big, you're important, we want to do trade with you, but we can't just sit down and, as the Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesman suggested, bow our heads down. Clearly, China wouldn't let that happen to it, and it's not going to happen with other countries towards China.
OK, we saw the Chinese embassy speaking quite strongly this afternoon. They're calling Australia's response an overreaction. They don't seem to be budging. Should we expect more of the same? What is the end game here?
I think you should expect more of the same, but I would suggest separating the rhetoric. And there's been plenty of it here in the UK and other countries when this country has done things the Chinese doesn't like, and actually looking at what happens in reality on the ground. So first of all, getting the trade relationship back to normal, that's clearly very important because it involves jobs and lives, and also making sure that Australian citizens feel safe in China, that the higher education relationship, where lots of Chinese are in Australia, that remains firm, friendly, robust, but also safe. Those are the areas I think that we need to concentrate on in the liberal countries. The language, well, it's kind of annoying, but we lived through the Trump administration for 4 years, which was pretty rude about allies as well as about countries that were rivals. And I think it's a waste of time to concentrate too much on the language without looking at the substance of policy underneath. That's really where the important elements lie.
Professor Rana Mehta, great to get your insight. Thanks for your time this evening.
Thank you.
From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.